All right, if there is no other business that I've forgotten, we will introduce our distinguished speaker. And for that, I'm going to invite Sudhi Bose to the podium.
My fellow Kiwanians, our guest speaker today, in my opinion, is the living embodiment of the history of Virginia, modern Virginia. He was born in Richmond in 1950. He was a child of segregated Virginia. His brothers went to segregated schools. These early experiences must have lit the fire in this man to change his community, to make it better. And as I read on, you will see that that is exactly what Judge Newman did. He went to Ohio University, obtained his Bachelor of Fine Arts with honors in theater and political science, and then went on to Catholic University, Columbus School of Law, my alma mater, and obtained his Juris Doctorate. He went into private practice from 1980 to 1993, and during that time, he started his learning process in politics, government, and change. He was appointed commissioner in chancery. He was elected to the Arlington County Board from 1987 to 1993. He was voted chairman of the board in 1998. He was a member of the Northern Virginia Planning District Commission, a member of the Arlington County Planning Commission, chairman of the Arlington Fire Trial Board, president of the Metropolitan Washington Council of Governments, chairman of the Public Safety Policy Committee for Washington Council of Governments, founder, trustee, president emeritus of Arlington County Foundation, founder of the Arlington County Mentoring Program. With those experiences in government and politics, he was appointed circuit court judge in 1993 and was elected the chief judge in 2003. After donning the robe, he has lectured in various law schools. He has taught various CLEs, too many to name. He has served and taught on various forums and panels, and he has been elected and was chosen the Washingtonian magazine Best of the Bench. In 2013, my friend and colleague, David Oblon, conferred on Judge Newman the Arlington Bar Foundation prestigious Winston Award. And while doing so, Mr. Oblon said this: "This is a personal example of what makes him special. When sentencing anyone, he looks at the accused, not as an authoritarian, but as a father. A father looking at his son in a mixture of disappointment and hope that he will turn himself around. You can look at him finding a spark of goodness in each person." That type of sentiment has been shared by none other than Judge Newman's bride, Sheila Crump Johnson, the co-founder of Black Entertainment Television. When she was giving an interview to the New York Times prior to their wedding, she said this: "He reads between the lines, and he understands when I'm upset and what it's really about. He's a therapist." Indeed, Judge Newman, the child of segregated Virginia, has been the limelight, the spark in Virginia jurisprudence. It is my great honor, my pleasure, to introduce to you my fellow Kiwanis, Chief Judge William T. Newman, Jr.
Sudhip, I will pay you a little something later for all of that. It is quite an honor for me to have this opportunity to be with you and share for just a few minutes today. When I was asked to come and speak today, I said, what would the Kiwanis Club want to hear from me? And Paul Ferguson said, well, talk about anything you want to talk about. And I said, well, maybe, forgetting at the time, of course, that there would be quite a few lawyers here, but I was going to talk a little bit maybe about what it means to be a judge, what is it that we really do, and then maybe give you a few thoughts about a few things that do concern me as a judge on occasion. You know, as people all have perceptions about what a judge does and what we really are all about, but except for the lawyers, most people really don't know. But let me just say, I start up by saying this. You know, judges date back a very long time. I mean, when you think about back to about 11 B.C., when the first judges came into being, and if you read and know Jewish history, in the Old Testament, the judges were the governing leaders who were there to serve in place and instead of the king. Today, we usually think of judges as merely appointed or elected public officials with the authority to hear and decide cases and all sorts of things. But you know, when we think about that, it sounds a little boring. And my colleagues and I like to think of ourselves as more like kings. You know, the public has many views of judges from all of the numerous court shows. I mean, we think of Judge Judy, we think of Judge Mathis, Judge Alex, Judge Pirro, Judge Hatchett, and the judges on Law and Order. We all have some perception of judges. However, most of those perceptions of what you think judges are all about are probably not true. And it's interesting to note that, you know, recently they just had the miniseries about the O.J. Simpson case. That, and, you know, of course, that was the great trial of the century going back to 95. And we often think about that judge, Judge Ito, and what he went through. And, you know, in reality, what Judge Ito did in that trial is most like what judges really do. They are there, and judges have to wrestle with a lot of interesting decisions that have to be made on the spur of the moment, on the fly. And that's what happened in that case, and it was kind of interesting to watch when they did the miniseries. That was really, they did, I think, a great job of this episodes that I saw of portraying what was perhaps one of the most difficult times in our country, and not only in terms of the legal system, but also in terms of dealing with certain social things that were there that caused some problems, even in terms of racial issues, and especially when the verdict was rendered. But you have to make a distinction between what real judges are like and what you see on TV, because what you see on TV is really just entertainment. And I assure you that if any judge did some of the things that Judge Judy did, they would not be sitting as a judge very long. because that just would not be allowed. You can't deal with or speak to people the way you often see occur on TV. And also, people also don't make a distinction between, that a judge is a judge. And they don't realize that judges, like, for example, even in our local state court system, in Arlington, for example, there are three different types of judges. Most people don't make any distinction. They think, well, one judge does, they all do the same thing, and that's not exactly true. For example, we have what we call general district court judges. And I always think of the general district court as the people's court, because most people will never go beyond the general district court. For example, if you get a speeding ticket, or a ticket like that, you go to the general district court. And generally, when you go to the general district court, it's a larger court, lots of people there, because that's the court for the most people, will only court they will ever attend. That's because that's where the traffic cases are heard, the petty criminal cases are heard, and smaller civil actions, like a landlord-tenant case or that type of thing, all occur in the general district court. Where civil actions have a maximum of about $25,000. And then, of course, we have those are the judges who preside over those cases. Unfortunately, those are cases that has a lot of volume because you had a lot of people coming through. And then, of course, we have what is known as the juvenile domestic relations court judges. And they are, to me, have the most thankless job because they are dealing with people on a very personal level because they are dealing with families in crisis often. I mean, you have parents who have children who are in trouble, or children who are in need of certain services, and or they're dealing with issues between family members, or cases dealing with support and custody. Very difficult cases, and those judges, I always take my hats off because they have to hear a lot of very difficult things. And then, of course, we have what is known as the circuit court, which I am a circuit court judge. And the cases from those other two courts are often appealed to the circuit court. And circuit court judges are what we call the trial court judges. That's where if you're going to have a jury trial on any issue, that's what the circuit court judges do. We also hear the major criminal cases, felony cases, rape, robbery, murder. Those cases all come to the circuit court. And we also hear all the civil cases where the amount in controversy is greater than $25,000. We also hear divorce cases. We do probate matters and also deal with cases that deal with injunctive relief, where we try to either prevent somebody from doing something or forcing them to do something. And you should always know that almost all cases in Virginia, almost all, can you have an absolute right by the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of Virginia to a right to a jury trial, except for in a few instances, like, for example, divorce. All other cases, for the most part, you have an absolute right to a jury trial. Most juries and people say, well, what happens in a jury trial? Well, jurors, they make the decisions regarding things like facts, credibility, and so forth of witnesses, and judges are there to establish what the law is. And despite what most people think, that trials go on for weeks at a time, the average trial in Virginia lasts 2 days. Most people don't realize. I always say that the OJ case, for all of the months that that trial went on in Virginia, we could have tried that case in 6 weeks.
Yeah.
No question. I mean, very few trials. I say that as I have a trial that's coming up in the next month, as opposed to the last 3 weeks. But for the most part, but that's rare. It doesn't usually happen that often we have trials. Most of them last only 2 days. And I always tell jurors that don't worry, you won't be there that long because the cases don't last that long, because in Virginia, judges have a lot of authority to move things on. I always remember the great Orrin Lewis. I see his name up here. When he was in the federal court, and he asked the attorneys, he said, how many witnesses do you have? And the lawyer says, I have seven. And Judge Lewis says, well, give me your best two. Judges in Virginia have a lot of authority, and they can cut things off. And if they think things are being cumulative, you just add on. We can say, no, I don't need to hear from another witness. So we do have a lot of discretion. You know, a lot of people think, say, well, to be a judge, you must be really smart and know a lot. Well, not necessarily so. certainly most attorneys, as they practice over the years, tend to develop an expertise in a particular area of the law. And sometimes you may even have expertise in a couple, but you know, as a judge, you're asked to rule on all sorts of things, a myriad of things. And all I can say is that from the day you become a judge, the first thing you want to do is make sure that the lawyers do the work and that the lawyers educate you on what the correct law is. I think that the only thing you require, if you're a judge, you want to be reasonably intelligent. I like to think that if somebody brings me the law, and I can look at the law, I can make the right decision if it's there. So you try to make lawyers do the work for you, because the lawyers, they're the experts in a particular area. They're the ones who know. And if you have good lawyers before you, I always say that when I have really great lawyers before me, everybody's game gets better. It's like playing tennis with somebody. You play somebody who has a good game, your game gets better because they are bringing their game. And so when you have good lawyers, it makes a life as a judge a very simple thing. And we're able to make usually the right decisions, to the point that a study was done. And believe it or not, they did a study a few years ago, and they said that 90% of the time, it was 89 point something, 90% of judicial decisions on appeal are correct. So the judges are usually, not always, but usually getting it right. And it's because hopefully if the lawyers have done their job, and the other thing is to make sure you've hired a great law clerk. I always say that my law clerk is smarter than I am, because they are really sharp individuals. You hire good law clerks and you have good lawyers, you can do your job and get it right most of the time. But you have to remember one thing. Whenever you have a trial, the law does not say that you have to have a perfect trial. The law says you're entitled to a fair trial. That's what the law is. So if minor mistakes are made and on appeal, that's still okay, as long as the ultimate decision was reasonably correct. Because you're only entitled to a fair trial, not a perfect trial. And that's the way it is. I will say this. When I became a judge, it was sometimes one of the more difficult things. Because as you heard, I had been in public life, as I was pleased to have served on the Arlington County Board, in fact, with my good friend back here, Senator Mary Margaret Whipple. We served together on the county board for a number of years. And so when I became a judge, that was very difficult, because all of a sudden, when you become a judge, you can't be outspoken. You can't say certain things, no matter how much you want to. And after being a politician, where I was used to jumping up and responding all the time, it was very difficult at first, because even when you're attacked, you can't say anything. I just found out I made a ruling in a case not too long ago, and I guess the parties were not happy, and I had become a product of a number of things on social media. But I really I can't comment or respond to that at all. Just say, well, okay, that's the way it is. And that's one of the one things that I have found sometimes a little difficult about being a judge, and one of the things that sometimes has concerned me. But it is what it is. You take the job and you go with it. The other thing about you have to remember when you, as a judge, you are making decisions that really are going to affect people's lives, their liberty, their families, their property. So you have to take the job very seriously, because you are dealing with people and their existence. And one of the most difficult things, people say, well, what's the most difficult type of case you have to hear? And most people say, well, it must be the criminal murder trial. Mm-hmm. No, the worst cases and the most difficult things for me to hear are the family cases, the cases that have an appeal from the juvenile domestic relations court, because you are really then dealing with people and families. And those cases are difficult because you're dealing with families in crisis often. And in fact, you see good people, sometimes two good parents, but because of the difficulties they're having, you're seeing them at their worst. People who, they will fight to the just over nothing, just because they're angry at each other, and sometimes forgetting that the best interests of their children would be if they would try to work together to resolve issues. Custody and visitation cases are the most difficult cases you have to hear as a judge. That's why I have such regard for juvenile domestic relations judges, because they do it every day, and I only have to hear it periodically when it's been appealed to me or as a part of a divorce case. And it's interesting, judges often are threatened by people, but we receive more threats as a result of domestic relations cases than any other type of case, believe it or not. Those and more judges have been attacked or whatever as a result of a domestic relations case, as opposed to something you might think of, a murder case or something else. And that's not to say that I haven't had a few threats from in murder cases or those types of criminal cases. A few years ago, I had the, the pleasure, it wasn't a pleasure, experience, rather, of trying a gang murder case that had occurred here a few years ago in Arlington. And I remember, because of the concerns and some threats that were made, Arlington's SWAT team was in the back of my courtroom in full riot gear, just in case something would happen, because they weren't sure because of the threats that had occurred. And for a while, I even had a little protection in my neighborhood because of that incident and the threat. As it turned out, nothing happened, and but it is, that's part of the job as well. Sometimes, depending upon the type of case, you do get the letters and threats being made. The other worst thing for a judge is criminal sentencing day, which, as Sudeep says, that's the day that really, to me, as a judge, the rubber does meet the road, because there, most people don't realize that at the end of a trial, and maybe the jury renders a verdict, but that is not actually sentencing day. Sentencing day usually occurs maybe 6 to 8 weeks after a trial is over. And it's a day that often brings together, well, certainly will bring the defendant there for the judge to render a decision as to what's going to happen. But also what happens is often family members of both the victim and of the defendant are there. And, you know, no matter how heinous that defendant was, he came from a family, and he has family there, often has kids there, and a mother, father, or whatever. And it really is sometimes difficult. And then you have the victim's family there. And then at the end of a sentence, you may have two sides of people sobbing and crying. The victim's family, because of the cathartic experience of just being there and having it happen, of course, for them it's hard. And then, but you have the defendant's family, and they're there as well. And they're good people, even though maybe their son or daughter was the one who perpetrated sometimes a very terrible crime. So the pronouncement of a sentence in those cases, for me, is often very difficult. And it becomes sometimes more difficult because, as someone who grew up in this community and has lived here my entire life, I often know, you'd be surprised how many times I know some of the people who are involved. It happens a lot. I may not be close friends with them or whatever, but I know them. Or I know one of the other family members and so forth. And it is very difficult. And sometimes, just 2 weeks ago, I was there and I said, I wonder why that particular person is in my courtroom. Because I looked down the list of people and I said, well, no, I mean, it turns out it was their nephew that was there in the case. And I didn't realize because I hadn't seen anything in what I had read, but it happens often. And it becomes sometimes hard as somebody who grew up in this community to have to deal with that. But it's part of, again, what you have to do as a judge. I also have to say there's a certain intellectual fear as a judge, because on the other side, we're not dealing with the criminal side. We have to also do what we call the civil side. And on the civil side, that's where you really see some really high-dollar lawyers showing up. And often, there may be five or six of them before you at one time. And I'm reminded of a case I had a few years ago. It was a case that really dealt with Ritz-Carlton Hotels. And actually, I don't know why this case was not tried in federal court. But, I do know why, because in the contract that the parties had entered into in a construction case, they had said that for whatever reason, if any litigation ensued, that it would be tried in a circuit court of Arlington. And I'm not sure whether they were working on the contract in a restaurant somewhere in Arlington or what, but that was very strange, because it wasn't in federal court. It just seemed logical this where this case was going to be tried. But the thing I can say about this case is that the Ritz-Carlton Hotels, which it was owned by a Saudi prince, because Ritz-Carlton doesn't really own most of the hotels. They flagged the hotel, but that's usually owned by somebody else. And this one was owned by a Saudi sheikh. And he was being sued in a construction case for some things that didn't go right. And a lawyer from the lawyers in the case representing the subcontractors and so on, there were 15 lawyers in the well of the courtroom, each representing a different entity in the case. I remember one of the lawyers, he represented the Goldman family in the OJ case, interestingly enough.
Petricelli?
Yes. Dan Petricelli. Dan Petricelli was flying in every other Friday from California because he was representing one of the construction people. I had lawyers from Chicago, New York, and then local counsel here in the area. And the funniest thing I always will never forget about this one case is that Mr. Petrocelli wanted to a deposition of the sheikh. And so he said, you know, they were there to argue about where this deposition should take place. And Mr. Petrocelli wanted the sheikh to come here and so forth. And the sheikh's lawyers were there, and they said, Mr. Petrocelli, the sheikh does not intend to be in the United States over the next month or two, but he is prepared to send his plane to fly everyone who needs to depose him to Paris, where he will be glad to undergo the deposition. Mr. Petrocelli didn't miss a beat. He said, Judge, when I go to Paris, I want to go on my own dime. I want the sheikh here. He sued my client here. I want him here for the deposition. I said, but Mr. Petrocelli, it's springtime, Paris. He said, no, I want to do it here. I said, well, tell the sheikh that he has to make a plane, bring his plane to come here for the deposition. It did ensue, and luckily the case actually settled, but after spending about $7 million in legal fees. But as I was saying, sometimes there is the intellectual fear, because as a judge, you have to make decisions in an open courtroom full of lots of people. You know, I've often said, you know, it better be thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. But as a judge, you have to make the call right then and there. And sometimes that is the hardest thing that you have to do because you're doing it in front of so many people. But the absolute hardest thing I know as a judge, at least as a circuit court judge, when we have had to do capital cases. And luckily in Virginia, well, in this part of Virginia, Arlington, we don't have too many capital cases, very few. But that was certainly the most difficult thing I ever had to do as a judge, was to sign a death warrant indicating the date and time that somebody would be executed. And at that time, I always remember something that I remember I was told by a priest when I became a judge. And he told me, he said, remember something, Bill, he says, you know, only God is truly capable of judging. However, God has ordained that man should live under the law. And if you are chosen, always remember that whatever you do, make sure that you always tender your justice with mercy and treat all people with fairness and respect. And as a judge, that's what I aspire to do, and I hope that over the years that I've been privileged to serve this community, that I've done it as well as I can. Thank you.
A couple of questions. We'll start with Derek.
Yes, Derek.
Bill, how are you? Bill and I go back into the 70s when the young YMCA director had his young aspiring lawyer on the board, and launched my career, Bill, so thank you. My question is, I recently read a book, Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow, and she basically maintains that mass incarceration is the new way in which society controls largely the African-American population. Much like slavery did, ended by the Civil War, much like Jim Crow did, ended by the Civil Rights Movement, with Ronald Reagan's war on drugs and war on crime, the amount of people who are incarcerated has 5, 6, 7 times, I'm not sure what, and an overwhelming number of them black. And I wonder if you can comment on that.
Well, there's no question that one of the worst things that happened, for example, was when we get mandatory sentencing went into place. And it really meant that judges had very little discretion sometimes in terms of what they he or she could do with a particular case. What we found, like for example, when we start talking about drug laws, there would be mandatory sentences that required sometimes somebody to get 20 years for a small amount of drugs. And what happened was it became even more distinct because when you start talking about crack as opposed to cocaine. Now, crack, cocaine, and it's the same thing. Well, it turns out in the greater community, which is the, you know, predominantly white community, people use powder cocaine. Whereas in the ghetto areas, crack cocaine, which was cheaper alternative, would often be used. Well, for the same amount, they made a distinction, because crack is very addictive. You might get a mandatory minimum of 20 years for using that, whereas for powder cocaine, you may only get 6 months. As it turns out, obviously, in the black community where that crack cocaine was being used, people were being incarcerated for extended, long periods of time for nonviolent offenses, and it became very problematic. It's interesting to note that, I saw that the governor has now, of course, is trying to restore the rights of about 200,000 people. And I can only hope that that does survive, because one of the things that it troubles me and as a judge on any Friday is the whole idea that people, for the rest of their lives, have lost their rights. I mean, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that once you've done the crime, you got to do the time. There's no question about that. But once you've done your time and after some reasonable period, why couldn't you? Because what you do is then you create a whole subclass of people. Because once you are a convicted felon, there are many jobs you will never be able to ever have. There are many places that won't even let you live there if you are a convicted felon. There, you are, for the rest of your life, you become a subclass of a person. So to me, to be able to restore people's rights and so forth becomes very important, and I hope that somehow the means and methods, they are able to reach a way of doing that.
Another question?
Oh, you don't get a question.
Well, that's a question. I had a juror today, Judge Newman, watched the video that you're now appearing in for jurors, and they asked if he had any acting experience what he had appeared in, and I didn't have a good answer to that question, so I was wondering if you could tell us some of the things that you might have appeared on previously before you were a judge, or even while you were a judge.
Well, and you heard my undergraduate degrees in fine arts, and in another lifetime, I did do some acting. Before I went to law school, I spent a couple of years in New York, and I did appear on a soap opera for a couple of years. In recent times, as I think about getting to the age of retirement, I have started doing some acting again, occasionally have appeared locally in some things, and had a very small cutting role, very small role, in a movie that came out about 2 years ago, The Butler, that was on. Yeah. So if you watch fast, you'll see me.
All right. Paul, do you have a question?
Debbie
has.
Well, and I don't want to put you on the spot, and it may not, I don't know, but I'm interested in the Supreme Court and McDonald's appeal, and whether or not, since it's a split vote, whether you think, if you've been paying any attention to it or not, and I don't know whether you have, whether or not the attorneys have done a really good job for him before he got to that step.
I'm not sure about before they got to that step, because I think that they were dealing with the law as it was being interpreted. I think that the argument for the Supreme Court was fascinating in terms of the questions that the various justices were asking of the lawyers, because it really does create it's a very fine line, that the whole law as to whether or not the governor did at that time was in violation of the law or not. And I don't want to comment on that beyond that. I just think the questions were fascinating, and I think that it really, we may see some changes result in the law and how it is interpreted as a result of what happened there. And I'm just curious to find out how the justices will come down on that and when they decide that case. I'm very interested, yeah.
Maybe one more.
Okay. From the standpoint, Arlington is a wonderful community and wealthy, et cetera. Is there something that is lacking in the judicial system now that you wish could be achieved or could be brought into the county that's not here?
Well, I'll tell you the thing that troubles me more than anything is that even though we have certain things, and we have the Arlington Services Board that works with mental health and so forth, there's still a void. You have no idea how often on a Friday sentencing we will have someone who's there who doesn't necessarily meet the criteria of somebody who needs to be perhaps committed. Well, they do, but they, you know, they, there's no facility or a place for them because they're sort of like in between. So do you put them and just put them in jail? But they really just not really mentally, you know, able to survive even in jail because they have to segregate them and keep them apart because they get taken advantage of while they're incarcerated and so forth. But there is an area here in the community, not only in Arlington, I think generally in the whole criminal justice system, for people who need help, but there's no place to do it because, yeah, you could send them down to Western State to a very, that type of situation, but that's not necessarily what they need either. It's something in between, and I think that's an area that more and more we're going to need to look at as to how do we help these people who have some real mental health issues but don't qualify to go maybe to Western State or one of those hospitals, but at the same time, you can't release them to the street, and so what do? Just put them in jail? I mean, so what do you do with them? And it becomes like, I know there are many times I say, I don't know what to do when you have certain individuals like that. So,
do you know of a program somewhere else that addresses that issue?
You know, we were talking about, I went to in fact, I'm getting ready to go to another judicial conference, in fact, next week. And it's one of the things that we're going to talk about at the conference to see is something that maybe we could propose to tell our various delegation. Something that they may want to consider to look at in the future. So it's something that's it is on the table because a number of judges just don't know what to do with some of these individuals.
Thank you.